Good evening. Clock on the wall says 6 o'clock, and I hate to interrupt good fellowship, but it is time to begin our worship services. We want to welcome each and every one. We're glad that you chose to be with us for our evening worship services here at Bobby Branch Church of Christ. As we prepare our minds for worship, if you would like to go ahead and turn in your Bibles, our scripture reading this evening will be Matthew 7, verse 12. Matthew 7, verse 12. Once again, thank you for being with us. We know that we have visitors, and we're glad that you chose to be with us as well. We have some MIAs back with us this evening. A lot of our youth and parents are back after another great weekend for spring youth retreat. I'm looking around at eyes. Most of them look open at this point. I think I'm sure there was not sufficient sleep over the weekend, but we're glad that all of you are back safe and sound, and glad I've heard that you've had a really good weekend. So we're glad that you were able to participate in that. Do want to remind all the congregation we meet each Lord's Day at 9 a.m. for a period of worship. It's followed at 10:15 by a period of Bible study. We have this service each Sunday evening at 6 p.m., and we have a midweek Bible study on Wednesday evenings beginning at 7. If you are with us and you're in search of a home congregation, we encourage you to stay with us after services, get to know some of the members, certainly meet with our elders, and learn more about what our congregation is doing here to spread the gospel as well as edify ourselves in God's word. Do have just a want to update before we begin our services on a few announcements. Those that we know of that are sick and at home, there will be a wedding shower for Ashley Newby. Ashley is the bride-elect of Adam Fan. The shower will be on April the 14th from 2 to 4 at the home of Jeff and Mary Flatt. She is registered at Amazon and Walmart. So. Also, don't forget the Monday morning Bible class is tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. And also a reminder to those who may be interested, we are selling the bus shed that's out here in the parking lot. If you would like to bid on that, please do so in a sealed bid, and that would include the cost to remove it as well. And those are due if you're interested by April 4th. There are several gospel meetings, ladies' days, and things. I failed to mention this morning. There's actually too many to actually go through the list during the announcements, but they're posted on the bulletin board, and they're also in the Bobby banner as well. So I encourage you to take a look at those. But also want to remind all of us of our gospel meeting coming up April 21st through the 24th with Brother Chad Ramsey. And so our cards are in the back. And so please take the opportunity to invite your friends and family, your neighbors. The cards are very convenient to be mailed or to be just hand to someone. So Birthday Wednesday will be this Wednesday, the 27th. And also next Sunday evening, youth-led services. So our young people will be leading services next Sunday evening. Visitation Group 4, don't forget your meeting following services in Room 1. At this time, if you would please stand. Our first song is number 707.
Christ be
loyal and be true, his banner be unfurled, and borne aloft till it secure the conquest of the world. To Christ the Lord be true, ever true, for he will
sing number 316.
See you.
Shall we pray together? O Lord our God, we come before you tonight with happiness in our heart because we have the privilege of extending unto you the accolades that you so justly deserve and to place before you the petitions of things that we think we need and to ask you, Father, for your care and your continued love that you give to us each day. The love you shower down upon us, the patience you have with us, and the opportunities that you give us that we might be forgiven of those things that we do that are not right in your sight. And we ask you, Father, to look into our hearts tonight and to know that we are sorry for all the things we have done in the near present and the far past. Whether we remember them or not, make us repentant. Help us to shed those things from our life. Help us to be better Christians. And forgive us, O Lord, that the book of life shall contain only the good things that we have done. And help us to be better Christians. Help us to go out and to love the world. Help us to be an example to them. Help us to exonerate them and to show them that there is a heavenly place that we just sang about. Place where we can sing your praises and your accolades, where we can be with you throughout eternity. And we know that hope is there for everyone. So let us live it, help us to share it, that we can bring souls to Christ. We thank you, Father, for the group of Christians that assemble in this place. And we're thankful that your church is strong throughout the world. And we know from time to time we are fearful that the church might be in peril, but we know, Father, that you have promised, and what you promise you will execute, that your church will continue, that there will always be the opportunity to share the gospel, to spread the gospel, and to have that hope of eternal life. Thank you for our leaders, the leaders of this church, our elders who shepherd over us, who look out for our best, that we can stay in that straight and narrow way. Thank you for the leaders of our country, our state, our community, and even though sometimes it appears that they do not seek the best as set forth in your standard, the Bible, help us, Father, to let them know that that is the only standard by which man will be judged, and that they should consider your ways as the only ways that are right and true. We're thankful that our young people have had a weekend of fellowship to get to know each other better, to share your word, to be exalted in the things that they do well, and to ask them to consider the things that they might improve in their life. And we're thankful that we have such a strong group of young men and women who can be examples to their friends, their peers, and those who mentor them. May they always seek to do the things that would make them continue to live in the heavenly ways and to promote Christ as their Savior. Tonight, we pray that you will be with us as we continue through this service. Help us, Father, to sing praises from our heart. Help us to consider the words that are put before us. Father, when we leave this place, we pray that your protection, your love, and your care would be upon us, and that we truly can live a life so that when our eyes open in eternity, that heaven will be our dwelling place throughout the ages. In this prayer, Father, we ask in Christ's most holy name, and amen.
In just a little while, when the invitation is extended to us, we're going to sing number 584. And now let's sing number 807, Precious Memories.
Precious memories, unseen angels,
This evening's scripture reading is Matthew 7:12. Therefore, whatever you want men to do to you, do also to them, for this is the law of the prophets.
Preachers rarely know what the song leader is going to lead before the service. Tonight, I thought, when I saw Precious Memories, that's generally a song you sing at a funeral. And I thought, well, maybe it's Stanley trying to tell me something. And then I thought, Precious Memories, maybe he's hoping my memory will be good. So, you know, those are beautiful songs, but sometimes they do make us think, at least he didn't lead ready to suffer. So we'll try to do the best we can. Tonight, we're continuing in a series of lessons. In fact, this will be the last one in a series of questions that have been asked that I preach on specific moral issues. And tonight's lesson is going to be one that will talk about the gift of life and in the fact that many people want to end that life in the most precious, the smallest, and the most innocent of people. You see, some sins of man seem to be very cruel, and some are even more heinous and even more barbaric and cruel than others. You know, I wouldn't want to see someone who would be beaten beyond recognition. I wouldn't want to see a woman to be mistreated. I particularly do not like to see elderly people abused. But when you think about the most innocent of society, some people seem to feel no shame and no embarrassment from the practice of abortion. It appears that our society today has lost this sense of ability with regards to the respect of life of another. In the book of Ephesians, chapter 4, verse 19, Paul writes, "Who being past feeling have given themselves over to lewdness to work all uncleanness with greediness." Notice their past feeling. There's nothing that seems to make them feel awful anymore about doing such barbaric acts. Or you can read in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2, he talks about people whose own conscience is seared with a hot iron. That is, they no longer are able to feel anything. And our modern society has literally become sick with sin. If you don't believe me, watch the television shows and you'll see how sick our society has become. And we have become entertained by it in so many different ways. And this degeneration of morals is resulting in the destruction of our own society. Yes, we in the United States, in the state of Tennessee, are seeing our nation fall apart because of the degeneration of morals. In Hosea chapter 7 and verse 9, he says, "Aliens have devoured his strength, but he does not know it. Yes, gray hairs are here and there on him, yet he does not know it." It appears that so many people do not realize what we're doing to ourselves. In Isaiah 57, verse 1, "The righteous perishes, and no one takes it to heart. Merciful men are taken away, while no one considers that the righteous is taken away from evil." When good men, righteous men, are perishing and they are being replaced by people who have no love for their fellow man, the passage that Jason read to us just earlier, that we are to treat others as we ourselves want to be treated, which is the way we paraphrase Matthew chapter 7 and verse 12. But I will point out to you that society is cyclical. That is, things that have been now have been before. In the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 1 and verse 9, Solomon would say, "That which has been is what will be. That which is done is what will be done. And there's nothing new under the sun." Yes, we are living in a difficult time and a challenging time. These types of times have been here before. Now, what I would like for us to do this evening is to look at it from three different aspects. First will be worldly wisdom. You know, Paul spent a lot of time trying to explain how the worldly mind thinks, particularly in the book of 1 Corinthians, and how that worldly mind can sometimes infect those of us who are in the church. So we're going to look at the worldly wisdom, the way the world thinks. Then we're going to move beyond that to what's more important, to looking at the words of divine wisdom, how God speaks on the subject. And then to just very briefly touch on a people without a natural affection. So if you will, let's begin first of all. And some of this will be some things you know, some of it you probably may not know. And what you have to do to appreciate this world is to look at the way that they argue. Look at their arguments, or look at their reasons, if you will. The organizations that are promoting abortion today do so under the guise of being pro-choice. Let me reemphasize that. They say we are pro-choice. They are pro-one choice, not pro-many choices. The three organizations that I'll mention to you are NARAL, which is the National Abortion Rights Action League, Planned Parenthood, and then the Guttmacher Institute. And if you've not become aware of any of these, I will give you a little bit of information. The Charlotte Lozier Institute has recorded some of the statistics from Planned Parenthood. And Planned Parenthood in 20 and 21 performed 374,155 abortions in the United States. Now, that's just a portion of what's being done. That made up 97.2% of their pregnancy resolution services. In other words, if you ask them, what are you doing? We're performing abortions. That's 97% of what they're doing to resolve pregnancies. Their Planned Parenthood income reported $1.9 billion in income. I don't think it takes a rocket scientist to realize what's taking place here. This is big business. This is money-making. And this is a group of people who are telling us that they're trying to plan parenthood. It is not Planned Parenthood. It is planned death. Because if all you're doing, and that's just about 97% plus, is about performing abortions, that's not Planned Parenthood. That's planning death for those children. The Wall Street Journal, on October the 27th, 2023, that's just a few months ago, had a real serious article. And I read it, and I was shocked, disappointed, discouraged. It said, and now that Roe v. Wade is gone, but abortions are on the rise. I thought, that can't be true. And it said in Dobbs versus Jackson versus the Health Organization ruling from June 2022, it ended federal protections for the procedure and paved the way for some 16 states to ban most abortions. Many are most abortions. Now, you would think that if a number of states had banned abortions, that the number would go down. But it said nationwide there were 183 more monthly abortions on average the 12 months following the Dobbs decision compared with the months prior to it. In other words, the abortions are going up. And you're saying, but surely that can't be the case. We thought when the Supreme Court ruled on the Dobbs decision that that's going to stop abortions. It did not stop abortions. What it did, it pushed them into different places. But more people are getting them than ever before. Well, who's getting the abortions? About one quarter of all pregnancies now are ending in abortions. In other words, every four women that gets pregnant, one of them is aborting their child. 80% of the abortions are performed on unmarried women. That's according to the Centers for Disease Control. 50% of the women obtaining abortions are younger than 25, and 33% are women in the age bracket of 20 to 24. And then the teenagers, 17% of them. And one of the things that the Guttmacher Institute posted, which I just shook my head at and I can't believe, around 1% of the abortion patients do not identify as female. What's wrong with our society? When people are thinking, well, I'm sure that the men are not getting pregnant. I don't know what else is, you know, I'm guessing there's something else. But here's the problem. Our society is sick. And what they continue to do is they want to make it more accessible. But now, here's a map that was produced by the Guttmacher Institute. And those that are in dark red, and I'll turn around and look and see, I guess it's burnt orange on the screen, are the states, including Tennessee, where it is highly restricted. Those that are in orange are very restricted. Those that are in the darker yellow, they are restrictive. But then you start looking at the blues, and those are the states where it gets to be a little more protecting of those women who want to get abortions. And if you'll notice, there's one state that's very dark blue, that's Oregon, and that's where it's the most permissive. Of course, you will notice those out near the left side of the screen, the West Coast, that they're the ones who are the most accepting of it. Now, what kind of arguments are they suggesting that makes this so? Well, they will say laws don't stop abortions, they just make them less safe. Well, I would beg to differ, because in the state of Tennessee right now, abortion is considered to be illegal, and it has definitely stopped them here in Tennessee. That means that children who are conceived here have a more likelihood to live. They say religious foundations should not be the basis of our laws. They would say our Constitution guarantees freedom of religion. And what they're saying is not freedom of religion, freedom from religion is what they're wanting. They don't want any kind of religious foundations. Well, if you divorce all moral behavior from our laws, then why would lying be wrong? Why would stealing be wrong? Why would any other murder, rape, or any other behavior be wrong? You see, if there's no moral foundation to anything. Most people against abortion, they say, will never become pregnant. And particularly, they're saying men. I don't know how they can say that anymore. If you can identify as whatever you want to be, then how could they say that? Women who are raped or victims of incest should not be forced to carry that burden. Well, should society be forced to carry the burden for them and what they are doing? You see, the truth is, they're not looking at the perspective of the child. They're looking only at the perspective of what the mother wants and the selfishness that are there. They also would say a free society should not invade the privacy of a woman's body. What about invading the privacy of the child that's in the woman's body? They say it's a medical decision and not a moral one, and they've tried to frame it in the terms of health care, when in reality, it's death, not health care. A merciful society should not force terrible handicaps on children. Society is not forcing handicaps on children. But I will tell you, some of the handicapped children are the most loving and the most appreciative of society. And we need to look at people who have physical handicaps as being people worthy of our love and our devotion. And we should never look at someone who has a handicap and say, well, they're not important. Do you realize that that devalues life for everybody? 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 20 and 21, Paul writes, who is the wise? Who is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know God, God pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. It's only when you and I go to God's word that we learn what real wisdom is. So let's do that. The Bible addresses this subject in so many different ways. You go back to the very beginning in Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7, and the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. God took and put the breath in man. In Acts 17, verse 25, Paul reflects the same thing by saying, he says, he gives to all life, breath, and all things. God is the giver of life. Man has no right to take it. Life begins at conception. And someone says, well, are you sure about that? That's a debated issue today. Well, listen, John the Baptist was a son when he was conceived and when he was born. In Luke 1 and verse 36, now indeed Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived in her old age, and now is in the sixth month of her who is called barren. Now look at verse 57. Now Elizabeth's full time came for her to be delivered, and she brought forth a son. You notice here that Luke mentions the conception. And that conception is when John the Baptist became a person. If I go further and read in Luke chapter 1 and verse 41, now it happened as Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary that the babe leaped in her womb and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. The babe leaped in her womb. It didn't say the fetus leaped in her womb. Verse 44, and for indeed as soon as the voice of your greeting sounded in my ears, the babe leaped in my womb for joy. Do you mean that even the babe that's in the womb can have joy? Absolutely. In fact, those ultrasounds sometimes can reflect the smile that's on a child's face. In Psalm 139, we often quote part of this. David writes, for you have formed my inward parts. You have covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret, skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed, and in your book they were all written. They are days fashioned for me when as yet there were none of them. Do you see how David so eloquently puts the fact that even when he was there unformed, that God already had in his book planned for David and his life, and how that God fearfully and wonderfully made him in his mother's womb. In Jeremiah 1, 4 and 5, then the word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you and ordained you a prophet for the nations or to the nations. Jeremiah was Jeremiah when he was in his mother's womb. God's view toward those who harm innocent children, and I would emphasize either in the womb or out of the womb, is very plain and clear. You go back to the Old Testament, and one of the things they were doing that just disgusted God was the way they were treating their children, particularly in offering them to the god Molech. Ezekiel chapter 16, verse 20. Moreover, you took your sons and your daughters whom you bore to me, and these you sacrificed to them to be devoured. Were your acts of harlotry no small matter? Now stop for just a minute. Were your acts of harlotry no small matter? And now he says, you're giving your children and causing them to pass through the fire. Or I think about what took place in Exodus chapter 1 when Moses was born. How Pharaoh decided that he was going to kill all the little male children that were born. And you read about that in Exodus chapter 1, verses 16 through 22. And I'm not going to go through all of that, but I can tell you those mothers had to be grieving because of the death of their young boys during that period of time. Much like that in Matthew chapter 2, you remember when Jesus was born, Herod learned about the birth of Jesus and knew about the time that it occurred. And we read in Matthew 2 and verse 16, now Herod, when he saw he was deceived by the wise men, was exceedingly angry, and he sent forth and put to death all the male children who were in Bethlehem and in all of its districts, 2 years old and under, according to the time that he had determined from the wise men. You see, the innocent children did not deserve to die or being killed by wicked men. The Ammonites reflect this disgusting practice of how they treated women who were pregnant. He said, for thus says the Lord, for 3 transgressions of the people of Ammon, and for 4, I will not turn away its punishment. Now here's why. because they ripped open the women of Gilead, or with child in Gilead, that they might enlarge their territory. Notice what they're doing. Women who are pregnant, they're cutting them open. Why are they doing it? So they can enlarge their territory. It's all about money. It's all about possessions. You see, in divine wisdom, abortion is murder. Oh, don't say murder, because that sounds too harsh. That's too inflammatory. But that's what it is. In 2 Kings 21 and verse 16, moreover, Manasseh shed very much innocent blood till he filled Jerusalem from one end to the other, besides his sin which he made Judah to sin in doing evil in the sight of the Lord. Since 1973, how much blood of innocent children has been spilled in our country? Someone says, you know, you think about all of those children whose lives could have been, and what kind of things that could have been done by them. Psalm 106, verses 37 and 38. They even sacrificed their sons and their daughters to demons and shed innocent blood, the blood of their sons and daughters whom they sacrificed to the idols of Canaan, and the land was polluted with blood. Today we have people who have the idea that we can sacrifice the blood of our children to satisfy what we want to continue to practice in illicit sexual activity, fornication. It's what the Bible calls it. In Exodus 20, verse 13, you shall not murder. Older translation, you shall not kill, but the idea is killing and murder. In chapter 21, verses 22 through 25, there's a discussion there about what would happen if a woman who has a child in her womb is hurt. He said, if men fight and hurt a woman with child so that she gives birth prematurely, yet no harm follows, he shall surely be punished according to the woman's husband imposes on him. He shall pay as the judges determine. But if any harm follows, notice this pregnant woman, now she has harm that follows, then you shall give life for life, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, hand for hand, foot for foot, burn for burn, wound for wound, stripe for stripe. What would happen if you kill that child in that womb? God says, just like taking anybody else's life. In 1 John 3 and verse 15, whoever hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. It's very plain and very clear that if you commit murder, you can't go to heaven if you don't repent of that sin. That's a sin that will send your soul to torments. But now, very briefly, let's talk about without natural affection. One who could kill the fruit of their own body has a calloused heart. I just cannot visualize somebody who would have a young girl or a young boy in the womb and then say, let's kill it. I want you to listen to Romans chapter 1 and verse 31. I'm going to read it first in the New King James and the original King James. He says, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful. The original King James says, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection. A natural affection is something that you should have, that you love your family. And to not love the fruit of your body is without a natural affection. Isaiah 49 verse 15, can a woman forget her nursing child and not have compassion on the son of her womb? Surely they may forget, yet I will not forget you. God says, you want to look at a natural affection? Every mother who is giving nursing to her child has that love. He said, may some possibly, but he says, I won't forget you. Micah 6 and verse 7, will the Lord be pleased with thousands of ram, 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I give the firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body, for the sin of my soul? Should that child pay for the sin that I have committed? That's really the bottom line in all of this. Should the child have to suffer because of what we've done that is wrong? Real love does good and not evil. Romans 13, verse 10, love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. And then we go back to Matthew 7, 12. Therefore, whatever you want men to do to you, do also to them, for this is the law and the prophets. I'd like to ask each one of us, ask ourselves the question, how would you have felt if your mother had decided she didn't want you? And you say, well, I wouldn't have been here. I wouldn't have known. Aren't you glad that your mother had enough respect for life to see that you were brought into this world, but not only brought into this world, but cared for and loved and appreciated and taken care of? We ought to have that same love that for others that are not yet born. This is not a political issue. People who want to frame it in that terms have misunderstood what this is. This is a moral issue. This is a biblical issue. Rejection of God has some serious consequences to it. We've already talked about that numerous times. But in Romans chapter 1, Paul will talk about God gave them up three times. But in verse 28, he says, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things which are not fitting. There are people who are going to do that, but you look at the consequences that follow from it. But submission to God means that one values his life here, but more importantly, he values the life to come. Because if I don't respect you, then how should I expect God to respect me? Why not save your own life now by obeying the gospel? I know we have people who are not yet Christians here in our audience. And you need to become a Christian. You need to save your soul. In Acts 2 and verse 40, and with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. He was encouraging those people to obey the gospel so that they could go to heaven. They could be with God eternally. If you believe that Jesus is the Christ and you're willing to repent of your sins, confess your faith and be baptized tonight. Be added to the Lord's church. Those sins are forgiven. If you're one of God's children and you need to come back and say, I need to make things right. Beloved, God loves you. He's always loved you. And he's calling for you. We're going to sing the song softly and tenderly. And if you need to come, please do as we stand and sing.
Softly and tenderly.
one verse, number 519.
Thanks to all of you for being a part of our services tonight, and we're glad to have our youth and their parents and chaperones back with us tonight. The parents and the chaperones are all rested up. They had plenty of sleep and relaxation while I was up there, and with no interruptions of sleep or anything. So they've had a good weekend, and we're proud of them. Please remember those that were mentioned that are sick and shut in, and do whatever we can to comfort them with cards or calls or whatever is necessary. Visitation Group 4, remember your meeting tonight after the services. Those of you that hadn't had an opportunity to take of the Lord's Supper and give of your means, if you'll go now to the room and the back of the auditorium to the room on the left, there have been brothers there assigned to help you with that part of worship. But again, we want to ask you to take some of these cards and mail them out to your friends and neighbors, or give them to your co-workers, or whatever you can, to promote our gospel meeting. That is a very good way of doing it, and we hope that you'll take part of that. Monday morning Bible class in the morning at 9 o'clock. Our next service is at Wednesday night at 7. Please make plans to come back at 10. We'll sing this song and be dismissed. May God bless.
Only in thee, O Savior mine, dwells my soul.
Thank you for this day and all the many blessings. We thank you for the opportunity to assemble here and to study thy word. Heavenly Father, we ask at this time once again that you be with our sick, and our afflicted, our bereaved, and downhearted. And Heavenly Father, if it be thy will, restore them back to their normal walks of life. We ask that you bless the hands that minister unto them. And Heavenly Father, we ask at this time that you go with us to our respective places. Forgive us of our sins. Guard, guide, and watch over us in Christ's name. Amen.